is on the non-sporing anaerobes. These are the group of organisms which actually causes oral diseases specifically. And there are sporing anaerobes which causes the systemic diseases, like for example, tetanus or the gas gangrene, which is caused by Clostridium tetani and Clostridium perfringens. Those two organisms will be taken separately, but today we are going to discuss about a group of organisms which collectively classified under non-sporing anaerobes. Non-sporing, we know that these are the organisms which will not produce spores for their survival. And anaerobes, these are the group of organisms which does not require oxygen for their propagation or survival. These are the organisms which involved in the causation of various oral diseases such as gingivitis or the periodontitis. Of course, there are other oral diseases like dental caries, which is caused by the gram-positive cocci, which are aerobes. Coming to the introduction of these group of organisms, if you look at the number of organisms which are present in our various parts of your body, they are 10 to 30 times more frequently found than the aerobes. So they are the most predominant group of organisms in our various parts of body. 10 raised to 4 to 10 raised to 5 per ml of the small intestine constitute these anaerobic bacteria, non-sporing anaerobic bacteria. It means that they are heavily burdened or heavily present on the small intestine. And the usefulness of having these organisms in the small intestine, they do not allow the pathogenic microorganisms to establish themselves in the small intestine. So they're actually having a protective mechanism. If you look at in the saliva, there are 10 days to 8 per ml, which are present in the oral cavity. And till date, more than 700 species have been detected or identified, not detected, identified till date in the oral cavity. So everyone has these number of microorganisms, which are present in your saliva, in the oral cavity. If you look at the colon, it is 10 to 11 per gram of the colon. These organisms are present. And actually, they differ widely in their morphology, requirement of oxygen, and other biochemical and pathogenic characteristics. There were two classifications which were used to classify this bacteria. The old classification was based upon the cell and colony morphology, how they appear on the various culture media. On the basis of that, the classification was derived. And the second criteria they have used was on the basis of the biochemical reactions. And the third, which is one of the most important criteria which they have used to classify these bacteria, is based upon their sensitivity to different antibiotics. But now, in the molecular techniques availability, the current classification is generally based upon the DNA-based composition. And also, we can classify on the basis of the fatty acids and products after their propagation. As we have seen in the gram-positive cocci, which was started by Bosley madam as staphylococci, which comes under aerobic to facultative anaerobe. But what we are going to study in different categories, cocci and bacilli. In the cocci, it is gram-positive, gram-negative. Similarly, in the aerobic bacteria also. In gram-positive, there are two main species, genus, which are important in the oral diseases, Peptostreptococcus and Peptococcus or Peptococci. In the gram-negative cocci, we will be learning about the Veillonella parvula. The species is Parvula and the genus is Veillonella. So this also present in the oral cavity. There are two important other gram-negative cocci which you have already studied is meningococci and gonococci. those are aerobic gram negative cocci. What I am referring now is the gram negative anaerobic cocci. So the example is only Veillonella parvola. There might be some other examples, but we are not concerned about the other organisms. We are concerned only about those which are pathogenic to human beings. Coming to the second, that is bacilli, endospore forming, which we are not going to study today, which will be dealt with individually on these organisms like Clostridia. And there's non-sporing. Again, it is divided into gram-positive bacilli and gram-negative bacilli. In gram-positive bacilli, the list starts with the Eubacterium, Propionibacterium, Lactobacillus, Mobiluncus, Bifidobacterium, and Actinomyces. Amongst these, Actinomyces are more important in the causation of periodontal diseases as compared to other gram-positive bacteria, which are non-sporing anaerobes. Propionibacterium, you might have heard this, it causes the acne. These are the organism which causes the acne. And the list of gram-negative bacilli includes bacteroids, Prevotella, Porphyromonas, Fusobacterium, Leptotrichia, Tryponema. All these are gram-negative bacilli which are non-sporing. And these are very important. Gram-negative bacilli which are non-sporing are very important in causing the oral diseases such as gingivitis and the chronic or active periodontitis. Third group is also there, spirochetes, Tryponema and Borrelia. These two organisms will also be conducted separately in the different lectures. So we are not going to study of those bacteria. When I was referring chronic periodontitis, it is the inflammation of the gingival, which leads to the loss of connective tissue. And finally, there is a mobility in the tooth and then loss of the tooth, and which is predominantly caused by Porphyromonas gingivalis, you can see there. And then below that, there is a gram stain morphology of Fusobacterium. And then to the right, it is the spirochetes, which are spiral. Now we will study one by one. Anaerobic cocci are important, and they are divided into gram-positive and gram-negative groups based upon what stain, primary stain they accept or they lose after decolorization, which we will be studying today in the practical, today in the practical of gram stain. And there are two main genera which I have already told you, that is Peptostreptococcus and Peptococcus. They're very small in the size. It ranges from 0.2 to 2.5 micron, similarly as of the staphylococci, but again little smaller than the staphylococci. Many of them are aerotolerant. It means that if you cultivate them in the aerobic environment, they still grow in that aerobic environment to a certain extent. But if you keep continuing aerobic environment, they will die. So for a period of time, they will tolerate the oxygen environment. So this is one of the identification tests about the anaerobic cocci also. What do you do when you isolate any cocci from the specimen of patient? You first inoculate onto an aerobic culture media and put it into the incubator, and see next day whether there is growth or not. If there is a growth, it means that they are aerotolerant. And if there is no growth at all, that means they are complete or obligatory anaerobe. And to enhance their growth, you can grow them in the presence of 10% of carbon dioxide. So they are very loving to the carbon dioxide. They are normal inhabitants of vagina, mouth and intestine. So they are normal inhabitants of our various parts of our body. And mainly they causes puerperal sepsis, genital infections, wound infections. Wound infections, when it goes, the wound goes deeper where the oxygen level is very low, there these organisms will multiply and propagate themselves and cause the further loss of, I mean, destruction of the connective tissues. Gangrenous appendicitis, UTI, urinary tract infection, osteomyelitis, and abscesses in the brain, lungs, and other internal organs. It means that they are very important pathogens for causing various groups of diseases. They are often seen in pus by gram stain. You don't have to do much. You just stain with the gram stain and see the 0.2 to 2.5 micron. And if they grow in the anaerobic environment, and later they, if you see that they are aerotolerant, you can classify them as a non-sporing anaerobes, which are either Peptococcus or Peptostreptococcus. When I'm saying Peptostreptococcus, it means that they are in chains. When I'm saying it is Peptococcus, it means that they are in the bunch. The common clinical isolates includes Peptostreptococcus magnus, Ursacrolyticus, Tetradius, and Prevoti. And in the gram-negative cocci, there is only one species, which is Veillonella parvula, which is gram-negative cocci, which is also a normal inhabitant of mouth, intestine, and genital tracts. Fortunately, they are very sensitive to penicillin, chloramphenicol, and metronidazole. Whenever you see any oral diseases, you generally dental profession, they only prescribe metronidazole, which will be taken care of all the non-sporing anaerobes, which are important in the oral diseases. But nowadays, we could find some resistance to streptomycin and gentamicin. And even there are certain reports which shows that 2 to 3% or 2 to 5%, the non-sporing anaerobes are also shown resistance to metronidazole, which is a concern. But looking at the resistance number, it is not that great as compared to the resistance shown in the medicine by different organisms to different antibiotics. Anaerobic gram-positive bacilli, as I've already narrated the list, important you remember is the actinomyces. Actinomyces and actinomycetes is different. Actinomyces is a bacilli and actinomycetes is the fungi. They are strictly anaerobic, grow very slowly. They are the member of mouth and intestinal flora. They are commonly seen in the condition of periodontitis, aggressive and chronic periodontitis specifically. Eubacterium lentum is one of the important organism in the list, and Propionibacterium, which resides on the skin and is responsible for causing the acne. Propionibacterium acne, which is a common contaminant in the blood and CSF also, sometimes while collecting, because of their presence on the skin, they might contaminate these blood and CSF sample and you will get these contaminants. So you have to be very careful while reporting the growth in the blood and CSF. Lactobacillus is not that pathogenic. It is actually a friendly bacteria which is present in the mouth, intestine, and vagina. Non-pathogenic Lactobacillus cataniform is there, which sometimes involved in causation of bronchopulmonary infections. Of course, this is not that common. It is not an obligatory pathogen. It is common as an opportunistic infection in the immunocompromised patient and not the immunocompetent patient. Bifidobacterium is a pleomorphic rod. Pleomorphic means they change the shape. Sometimes they appear as a rod and sometimes they appear as a cocci. And they're present in the large intestine and the mouth. Anaerobic gram-negative bacilli, the important species are bacteroids, Fusobacterium, Leptotrichia, Porphyromonas, Prevotella, Tryponema, etc. Bacteroids are non-sporing, non-motile, pleomorphic, which are slender rods, grow well on the brain-heart infusion agar. They possess a capsule, which are normal inhabitant of intestine, respiratory tract, and the female genital tract. Bacteroids are also classified as ursacrolytic and sacrolytic. Ursacrolytic pigmented. The examples are Porphyromonas gingivalis, which is responsible for periodontal diseases. And Prevotella endodontalis causes dental root canal infections. And amongst the sacrolytics, that is Prevotella melaninogenica, Prevotella buccalis, and Prevotella denticola. You have to remember all these names because you are going to study in the fourth year in the periodontology subject, where all these organisms are explained in detail, their virulence factor, their diagnosis, their cultivation, culture characteristics, and everything, because they are important in causing the periodontal diseases. Bacteroid fragile is recovered from blood also, peripleural fluid, CSF, brain abscess, wound, and urogenital infections. Fusobacterium, they are very long, thin, spindle-shaped bacilli with pointed ends. It looks like a spindle. That is why it has been named as a fusobacterium. And there is one species that is nucleatum, which is a normal inhabitant of the mouth and is found in oral infections and pleuropulmonary sepsis. The second species, which is also their necrophorum, produces a wide range of exotoxin, which causes liver abscess and other abdominal infections. Now, coming to the anaerobic infections which are caused by these non-sporing anaerobes, they are usually endogenous because they are part of your various systems and are caused by tissue invasion. They are normally present on the skin, mouth, nasopharynx, upper respiratory tract, intestine and vagina. So they do not cause actually the infections in the immunocompetent patient, but they are very important in the immunocompromised patient as an opportunistic infections. Or even there is a depletion in the local immune response, still they may cause the oral diseases such as periodontal diseases in the mouth. Trauma, tissue necrosis, impaired circulation, hematoma formation are also associated with the anaerobic infections. These are very common in the diabetic patient, malnourished patient, malignancies. On prolonged treatment with the antibiotics, such as they act as a predisposing factor. So they are very common in these patients. Generally, anaerobic infections are polymicrobial. They are not monomicrobial. Do you mean by monomicrobial? It means that one disease, one causative agent. For example, cholera is caused by Vibrio cholera. Typhoid is caused by Salmonella typhi. Similarly, if you look at the etiology of anaerobic infection, it is a polymicrobial. You will get one or more than one organisms, or even three organisms at a time from that disease. So that is why majority of the anaerobic infections caused by non-sporing anaerobes are polymicrobial. Infection is usually localized. General dissemination occurs by bacteremia. Bacteremia, of course, we have studied presence of bacteria in the blood. If you look at the clinical feature, pus is the characteristics putrid with the pervasive nauseating odor because of the gases they produce in the during the propagation. This pus is very putrid and having a nauseatic odor. Exception is only bacterial fragilis, which has without odor. Pronounced cellulitis, common feature in the wound infections because it goes deeper and deeper where the anaerobic conditions are favorable, and that is why they found into the deeper wounds. Toxemia and fever are not marked. If you look at the various establishment of these bacteria in various systems in our body, Propionibacterium is the only species amongst these non-sporing anaerobes which resides on the skin. But if you look at the majority of the bacteria are there in the mouth and nasopharynx, intestine and vagina. Coming to the laboratory diagnosis, for any laboratory diagnosis, what do we need? We need a sample. So first, specimen collection has to be collected based upon the disease that patient is suffering from. But while you are collecting the sample for non-sporing anaerobes etiology, you have to avoid the resident flora because they may contaminate and they may overgrow, and you may not be able to come to know which non-sporing anaerobes was grown from that sample or specimen. For example, sputum is unsatisfactory for culture from suspected case of lung abscess. Instead, take material by aspiration. Why? Because while voiding the sputum, while coughing out the sputum, the oral other bacteria may also contaminate with the sputum and they will overgrow. So what is the best practice to find out the non-sporing anaerobic etiology from a suspected case of lung abscess? You have to take the sample by aspiration. So you are minimizing the contamination. Transport in a special medium, generally Robertson cooked medium is used, RCM, which you have studied in the culture media. That is the transport medium and also a propagation medium for the non-sporing anaerobes, including sporing anaerobes also. Aspirate a specimen into an airtight syringe and send it immediately to the lab. Pus and other fluids are collected in small bottles with airtight caps because you should not expose these organisms to the oxygen. What will happen? They will die and you will not be getting the growth in the culture media and you will report it as a no growth. So to avoid that, you need to airtight that caps while after collecting the samples. Swabs are unsatisfactory or sent it in a stewards transport medium. Generally, we don't. Why again swab? Because on the swab, the organisms are there on the surface of that swab and they get directly exposed to the oxygen, environmental oxygen, and they may die. So again, the report will be no growth. So you have to avoid taking swabs actually. They're unsatisfactory. But if you cannot avoid, you have to collect those swabs in a spatial transport medium and transport it to the lab. What do we do after specimen collection? We do the gram stain for aerobic or anaerobic etiology. Gram stain is very important. Gram stain is a principal stain which gives you an idea what type of morphological characteristics the organisms are possessing so that the physician and clinician can start the antibiotic therapy in that direction. There are antibiotics which will work better on the gram positive. There are antibiotics which work better on the gram negative. And there are few antibiotics which work on the gram positive as well as gram negative. Those are called as broad spectrum. So while reporting the gram stain, they will come to know what type of etiology they are suspecting from that specimen so that they can initiate the antibiotic in that direction. Otherwise, they start with the broad spectrum. And starting with the broad spectrum antibiotic is not a good choice, because once you start with the broad spectrum antibiotic and the organism shows resistance, then there will be no choice of antibiotics to treat that organism. So first starts with the specific treatment with the specific bacteria shown in the gram stain. Pus in anaerobic infection shows large variety of organisms and numerous pus cells. This is the identification characteristics from the gram stain. In brain abscess, a single organism is found. In brain abscess, you don't find the polymicrobial etiology. It is a monomicrobial etiology. Gas liquid chromatography is one of the important identification tests for presumptive information of these bacteria. So gas liquid chromatography is used to identify this bacteria. Generally, if you talk about the media, culture media used, freshly prepared blood agar with neomycin antibiotic, yeast extract, hemin and vitamin K is preferable. Neomycin blood agar is used for propagation of these bacteria, non-sporing anaerobes. Incubation as usual at 37 degrees Celsius in an anaerobic jar with 10% CO2, or you can also use gas pack system, which is convenient. Because in anaerobic jar, you have to evacuate the air first and then fill the vacuum inside the vacuum with the hydrogen, carbon dioxide, and sometimes the nitrogen also. So to avoid that filling, evacuation filling, you can use the gas pack system, which is very convenient. It is a gas pack which is having the chemical compound. When you just cut the pouch, keep it in the jar, and when it get exposed to the air, it sucks all the oxygen. It oxidizes all the oxygen present in the environment, thereby creating the anaerobic environment. Plates are incubated for 24 to 48 hours, more than that also, sometimes 5 days to 7 days. The incubation is a little prolonged in the anaerobic etiology, while in aerobic etiology, 18 hours is also enough. Parallel plates are also incubated aerobically, not to miss out the aerobic bacteria. Common anaerobic infections and their bacteria responsible in this table, you can see here, site and type of infection, bacteria which are responsible for that infection. Central nervous system, brain abscess, that means, and it is generally caused by bacteroid fragilis and peptostreptococci. The ENT, that is eye, nose, throat, where chronic sinusitis, otitis media, which is infection of the ear, mastoiditis, orbital cellulitis, which is generally caused by fusobacteria. If you look at the mouth and jaw, ulcerative gingivitis, dental abscess, cellulitis, abscess and sinus of jaw, or the periodontal diseases are main oral diseases which are caused by a variety of non-sporing gram-negative bacteria, including fusobacteria, spirochetes, actinomyces also, and other etiological agents. If you look at the respiratory, it can cause the aspiration pneumonia, lung abscess, bronchiectasis, empyema, which is generally caused by fusobacteria, Privertula melanogenica, anaerobic cocci, that is peptococcus or peptostreptococcus, and bacteroid fragilis rarely. In abdominal, they are responsible for causing hepatic abscess, appendicitis, peritonitis, ischiorectal abscess, wound infection after colorectal surgeries, and the bacteria involved in these infections are Bacteroides fragilis. In the female genital infection, they are generally responsible for wound infection followed by genital surgeries, puerperal sepsis, tubo-ovarian sepsis, Bartholin abscess, and septic abortion. And the causative agents include melanogenica, anaerobic cocci, Bacteroides fragilis, and genital anaerobes and Clostridium perfringens. Actually, Clostridium perfringens is not part of our today's lecture, but they are also involved in the causation of various genital infections. If you look at the skin and soft tissues, they are responsible for infected sebaceous cysts, breast abscess, axillary abscesses, and generally the bacteria involved are anaerobic cocci and melanogenica. Cellulitis, diabetic ulcer, and gangrene are caused by generally Bacteroides fragilis and others. So Bacteroides fragilis is the main causative agent for various diseases in various parts of our body, which you might have noted. This is the end of the lecture, which is little smaller lecture. You can end Arya or Chiti, whosoever is doing.